The roots of jungle and drum and bass culture draws back to Jamaica's influence of British musicians and the youth in the 1960s. This spurred the infamous dub reggae movement in the UK.
I would say the 50s, they would get radio transmissions from Florida, Alabama, and Louisiana playing rock music, you know, the rockabilly type stuff. They'd get those transmissions and try to emulate it, and it kind of had this like grooving sound, so they took that sound, made it into their own music. All the bands that would be playing at these events would take a break, and they would take a very long break, enough to where they would have to hire a DJ for the band to take a break, and the DJ would play in between. Well, next thing you know, they figured they could pay the DJs less than a full band, so then the DJs took over and the musicians were kind of out. Musicians went into the studio, and when they went into the studio, they started making the music, which the DJs would play. These DJs would then make up their own sound system, carry it around town, and then start throwing a block party.
The Jamaican sound system and sound clashes were all about who had the most bass and who could draw the biggest party.
It was who had the bigger system.
The reggae influence was always huge. The Jamaican and that whole influence was huge in jungle music.
Reggae made a huge impact on the world and helped in breaking down racial barriers through the 60s and 70s.
The creation of it more was I come originally into music scene in the early 80s in full reggae with one turntable. The whole DJ club thing didn't really exist in England or where I grew up at that point.
The reggae sound clashes were a major influence in the 70s and 80s and exposed the youth of London to the DJ culture.
And the reason MCs came aboard was because of the whole Jamaican sound clash and the way they would do it, you know, and the whole rewind. Junglists took that from the Jamaican thing, but I mean, nobody can take that from us. House people ain't doing rewinds, trance people ain't doing rewinds, you know what I mean? That's just a drum and bass dub type thing, you know, it's dub and kind of like that's our thing, you know.
Including the use of MCs who would be chatting or toasting to hype the crowd.
We used to go to reggae parties in Hackney. You know, I was probably 13 years old when I first got into reggae music and going to sound systems.
The world embraced Jamaica and the reggae culture. And in the UK, the youth made it a part of their evolving British urban culture. Ultimately, jungle and drum and bass fans also took from reggae's style, vocabulary, and love of bass and incorporated it into our culture, the junglist culture.
I was a punk rock kid and a metal guy. That's all I listened to, but I really liked 70s dub. And to me, that was the roots of it. When I heard that aggressive sound with 160 BPMs and rock on top, I was sold. It was like the marriage of both worlds that I love, you know?
In the mid-70s, the world heard the explosive beginnings of punk rock. This do-it-yourself music genre had punk musicians producing their own tracks and distributing their music through non-traditional avenues, including local record stores. Importantly, punk was a culture that developed outside the mainstream acceptance and became the prototype for the future outside-of-the-box musicians to help spread their sound and vibe.
I was always of the mind that, you know, reggae and ska really was a part of drum and bass culture.
Drum and bass has always been kind of like the futuristic computer music of punk rock.
UK punk, intentionally or not, was creating the mold for future musicians and especially junglists. The melding of music styles between UK punk and reggae and the punk rock attitude were making a statement across the world.
It's one of the only, you know, electronic types of music that can almost form a mosh pit.
Every like boy when he's a kid loves robots and like machines and things, and you just remember hearing all those like awesome sounds, and then but like now they're like musically arranged, but like with the aggression and attitude of like punk rock.
Much like punk and reggae, jungle and drum and bass was appealing to those not concerned with the mainstream media pop culture. It carried a rebel vibe and pushed the boundaries of music production and DJ mixing. Like the jungle and drum and bass soon to come, punk punk was the future music of its time.
As far back as I could think would be my sister, probably. She was into punk rock and stuff. I was only in like third or fourth grade at the time. I was really young, and you know, I looked up to her a lot, and she was listening to punk bands like Minor Threat, Fugazi, and you know, Black Flag, Dead Kennedys, and things like that. From there, you know, I played in punk bands all through high school. I got to college, and I didn't have my band anymore. I didn't have anybody to play with, to jam with, and I went to a party and saw Diesel Boy. And it was fast, hard, aggressive, and it was everything that punk was that I was into before that. And I really clung to it, and I started DJing shortly after my first party that I went to.
Yeah, I really think that being into the hardcore scene, like the punk hardcore scene back in the 80s, definitely influenced the routes that I took in what I liked about electronic music. Gotta be a VIP. I represent the hardcore. Yes, broken and raw. I represent the hardcore. Yes, broken and raw. I represent the hardcore. Yes, broken and raw. I represent the hardcore. Ultimately, the five principles of hip hop directly translate into drum and bass. You know, you've got the b-boy, the dancer, you know, the break dancer, you know, the DJ, the MC. And it's basically all linked to the way drum and bass is created, presented, and it's evolved directly from the same beliefs as hip-hop and b-boy culture.
There were all these reggae artists, these dancehall reggae artists that were taking hip-hop and kind of mashing it up and doing that. And when I started hearing jungle records, the early jungle records that were taking those same reggae records that I was jamming to already and starting to slice them up and put them onto these different things, that's when I really started getting turned on to it.
To me, jungle is a synthesis of all culture, music, and art that came before.
It was pretty much the birth of that scene as well, so it was kind of like, you know, it's just, you didn't really know what we were to expect at all. It was just happening at the time. So, you know, I mean, people nowadays, they get into it, and I know they like it, and I felt like there was a little bit of a different passion for it for me back then because it was just kind of so new.
We have to explain that. I mean, there's friends of mine that come out that ain't junglists, but yet they're friends of mine, and they say, whenever you're gonna play in Chicago, you know, I wanna go and check out one of your performances. I bring them through, and they got a handful of questions. Yo, why do you stop the music and rewind it? And why is the guy always screaming? And why, like, they're not junglists, you know? So once again, I'm 100% junglist, and being a junglist, you know about the MCs, you know about the rewinds, you know about the bows, and you know who your DJs are, and you know the different styles, and you know how to dance to it.
Every day, new listeners join the ranks of audiophiles and jungle and drum and bass enthusiasts called junglists. Across the nation and around the world, wherever you find a junglist, you'll find a community sharing similar tastes and attitudes.
People, I would say, danced a lot more back in the day. I mean, they really got down. I mean, people would leave the drum bass room just sweating from head to toe, I remember. You know, and people, they all had their camo on. It was like a lifestyle almost.
We are junglists because we love the music and it lives through us in our lifestyle, appearance, attitude, and verbiage. Most of all, it comes down to our love of jungle and drum and bass.
And it was tough because we were always the black sheep.
Yeah.
Oh shit, here comes Tezzy Quest. The junglists.
You know, the MCs rhyming and going off on the mic and the rewinds and, you know, the people going crazy and the bows and the fucking,
it's everything,
you know, just people, the one foot skanking and the people going crazy, you know, that's to me, that's jungle.
Yeah, it was extremely tough down here because the main promoters down here were house promoters, and from what they'd read about jungle, they didn't want anything to do with it. They weren't receptive to listening to it, so we'd have to tell them, you know, don't worry, we don't play that music, we play breakbeats.
Yeah, don't you worry.
Yeah, so we'd go there, like you said, we'd drop two or three breakbeat tunes and then go into the jungle and just see the whole crowd just split, you know, but there'd be like 5-10 people still dancing. To us back in the day, that was like, yes, we've won.
We got a full house.
Yeah, we succeeded, we got these 10 people in, next week it might be 15 people. It took us like 3-4 years, nobody was really, you know, receptive to listening to this music. So we like came to the conclusion, hey, let's do this ourselves. We don't need the rave scene.
Yeah.
And that was always, even back in the day when we're talking to like Curious, you know, or R.A.W. were like, let's form our own entity and get away from the rave scene and make jungle its own scene. Like, punk's got its own scene, hip-hop's got its own scene.
Yeah.
But that's because it was so challenging with promoters, and what we went through in San Diego, they went through in L.A., except the population's a lot larger out there, so it was, you know, it was accepted a little bit quicker than San Diego.
I was lucky. I made friends with this British cat, Rez, and he was just, you know, he had moved here from London. He was going to like college, and you know, he was like, "Look, man, I'm telling you, you're a junglist. What you like, it's jungle."
Kind of like hip hop in a lot of ways, you know. You got your like MCs, you know, with people dance a certain way to it. I mean, it really is like cyborg hip hop. That's how I would describe the scene, I guess. You know, it's like some weird futuristic kind of twist on that or something.
It went from the fun party kid vibe to the serious, like, you know, elitist vibe fairly quickly when I joined the scene.
It's a different vibe in England, but we embraced it, right? We took it as okay. Like, we all grew up with hip-hop, but here's something new that has, like, this crazy dynamic sound that really kind of fits in with what we know. Like, there's a DJ and there's an MC, and we can break to it, and there's break beats. It's, like, right there, right? It's, the connection is there. I think that's one of the reasons why America embraced it so much.
Drum and bass is the higher education of electronic dance music. At the Junglist University, the DJ is your professor. The MC is your counselor, and the party is your classroom. All of these elements play their important part in this education because jungle and drum and bass can be heard, but to understand a lifestyle as a junglist does, it must be experienced live.
I feel the drum and bass and switching bass lines and double drops, so you can just make a whole new sound out of two different tracks that nobody's heard before, and you just have the freedom to, you know, make something, you know, new and cool out of, you know, two tracks people haven't, I mean, have already heard before, but, you know, maybe haven't tried that combination or that switch up. And I just think there's way more dynamic with like bassline switches and just the mixing style you don't see in other genres of EDM.
The DJ is instrumental in spreading jungle and drum and bass across the world through the party, pirate radio, internet radio, and mixtapes.
Most like every other DJ does, you start out, you have a friend, a mutual friend who has turntables and is sort of pushing you towards wanting to DJ, and, "Oh, I'm doing this too, you should do it too."
I discovered there was DJ Hype, and he was one to be an early drum and bass scratch DJ. I was always scratching in the hip hop scene, but I didn't think that there was no room for scratching in jungle music or drum and bass music until I heard a DJ Hype.
I'm just playing what I think is good music for the crowd. Someone like Goldie with the teeth and the hair and the whole, you know, he had an image that was great, and the music he was doing was very different. And the one thing I respected about him was, even though he had all this commercial support, he didn't compromise, and he still doesn't. You know, his music, he weren't, "Right, I've got to make a hit, I'm signed." You know, he made music from his heart.
Not every mix is going to be perfect, not every mix is going to be on, but that's part of a live, you know, a live DJ set, is you're going to hear that stuff, but that's what kind of, that's what kind of makes it cool.
I think it's a much more effective tool if you can incorporate lots of different sounds into your sets as a DJ. It keeps things more fresh, you know, keeps things moving, keeps people more interested, and it, you know, has more of a an exciting element to your set if you're able to mix it up and surprise people in the middle of your set. That element of surprise is a really important tool in your DJ.
Obviously, I started with vinyl. Love vinyl.
Vinyl, once the epitome of a DJ's tool set, was significant with its use because it allowed the DJ to showcase their skills with on-the-fly mixing at live events.
If I could just play vinyl and be cool, and that's it, I would love it. It just has a better feel, just sounds better. just everything about vinyl so much better.
In recent times, it has become almost an obstacle for old school DJs to choose vinyl due to the fact that the turntable has been removed from the industry standard setup at clubs and events.
Vinyl's still as expensive as it ever was, like press up, but the demand for vinyl is, you know, just not like how it used to be.
I don't know how much longer I'm gonna do vinyl, that's for sure. I'm just, you know, breaking even on each release, pretty much. So it's like, you know, I'm just doing it for the love.
You look at it from the side and you can see the grooves, you know, so you can see the intro, you can tell where the drop is because it's thick.
Vinyl mixes are appreciated as a junglist culture standard and return to the roots of the DJ art.
Watching REW was probably a spoiled way of getting introduced to it because he did the Soundstorm doubles that night, which was just a complete assault on all my senses. It was all the angst I had in my life just wrapped up in watching this dude just tear this mixer apart.
The value of hearing a DJ mix live, on the fly, with skill, on analog or digital equipment has been degraded throughout society because of the lack of knowledge and education about the skill set and its core elements.
I grew up in a city of Carson, and in the city of Carson, there was always DJ battles. And so whenever you went to go DJ, it's like, it wasn't just about playing music, it was about scratching, about acapellas, and about doing really good cutting and tricks and things like that.
People always say stuff about Skibidi because he's a constant presence on the microphone throughout the whole set, but he actually gave me my first bit of like really good advice, and he was like, you gotta take the approach of thinking of the DJs like the steak and the MCs like the A1 sauce. Like, you're not really there for the main meal, you're just accentuating the DJ set.
As an MC, as a performer, you know, I get to like mingle with the crowd and let them understand this is how we play our music, this is how we act, this is how we celebrate the music that we've decided that we want to play or make.
At Jungle and Drum and Bass events, the MC will not only perform original lyrical works accompanying the performance of the DJ, the MC will also enhance the set by emphasizing a track, a mix, or a scratch trick a DJ may perform.
The MC is important because he helps tell the people what's going on. Those people that don't know that have heard are just hearing drum and bass for the first time. The MC can be that person that's like, this is what's going on, here comes the drop, you know, get people excited, get people involved.
The MC helps carry the party through energetic and persuasive chatting or toasting. This is at the heart of being a master of ceremonies, and it helps connect the energy and attitude of the party to the audience.
I try to find the euphoric feel of just being, for lack of a better term, epic. And it's not even about like me trying to be epic, it's like, how do we fit and make this party ill? I want to make sure that the crowd is having a good time. I will stare at that one person in the crowd who isn't moving, and like, our job is to make sure that I see a smile on that person's face at some point of the night.
It was really good for TC and I to work together because every Saturday night we were there. We had a code worked out. You know, we were in MC for a while. I would say word to TC. He would come from the bar, he would take the mic, he would rock for a while. When he needed a break, he would say word to Paz D. When it was prime time, we'd rock together. And we had a really good relationship, which part of MCing is that, and letting the music breathe and all that other, you know, all the other elements, and not just, you know, getting out your lyrics.
Lastly, the party, or classroom in the Junglist University, is provided so that jungle and drum and bass can be experienced properly by the junglist. This means live energy and a vibe that can be set for the audience.
There's a big difference between hearing it on headphones or, you know, computer speakers, even in a car, you know, like to be in a club, to feel the energy of it, be surrounded by people dancing, the DJ's playing stuff, you know, like you can't beat that. And the computer generation is realizing how valuable that is, that they need that too. And I feel like that's a great thing because it's connecting people like myself who grew up in a rave scene that was really a do-it-yourself situation where we would drive for hours to go hear a DJ we liked. We didn't have the ability to just download a mix.
Importantly, it is a social place. the audience is the catalyst for the proper junglist experience.
What makes drum and bass popular is just the vibe that the music brings and sort of the enthusiasm that the crowd participation, instills in the experience.
The energy and vibe shared by the DJ, MC, and audience brings together the three elements of the Junglist University, and the energy they can create in a live party atmosphere can be completely infectious.
Bass, beats, rhythm, booty, and blood. To me, that makes up jungle.
Energy, manic, organized mayhem.
Family, because no matter what crew we come from, when we all come together, it has that vibe.
Funky ass shaking breaks and beats. Breaks and beats.
Extreme low end and beer.
Proper vibes.
Sweaty, bassy debauchery.
Rave. We're all ravers, man, at the end of the day.
Rhythm, soul, technology, all kind of comes together.
Energy, rhythm, passion. I think there's a lot of passion in drum and bass.
Culture, community, passion.
The fluid dance moves, b-boy pop locks, and freestyle dancing. This is part of the magic of being at a live jungle and drum and bass party. Simply art being made on the fly with the vibe and energy of those around inspiring it all.
To me, it's more of a community thing than what other people might like think of for other types of music as a showcase of exponential proportions. Like some people think it has to be. It really doesn't, and I think at the end of the day, as you get older, you embrace those around you and you want those people to stay with you. And that to me is what it's become.
Jungle and drum and bass.
Since the evolution of the beat, the basic subgenre argument has always been between jungle and or drum and bass.
It's a massive debating point because you can talk to anybody and you'll always have these big massive debates. But to me it's clear cut. I could play one of my tunes, or not even another producer that's making sort of stereotypical jungle. And you'll play it to somebody and they'll say, that's jungle. You could play them what I'm saying is a drum and bass tune, and they'll say, that's drum and bass. So to me, there's a clear divide. It's complicated, and it's hard to put it.
I like to use drum and bass now because, for me, drum and bass is the more generic term. So that's what I tend to use. For me, jungle kind of reminds me of mid-90s drum and bass.
So what do you describe as the difference? What is the difference? The difference, what do you mean? There's no ragga samples in an amen. But if you go back to jungle, every track weren't ragga samples in amen. Everybody's got their own little sort of thing. I don't, I call it jungle drum and bass because not because I distinguish between the two.
The terms, jungle or drum and bass. What is the correct terminology?
It wasn't even really known as drum and bass back then. People called it jungle. And even before that, people called it hardcore.
Are jungle and drum and bass two distinct genres of electronic dance music?
I made my mistakes trying to figure out which one was jungle and which one was drum and bass at one point, but it's all relative.
Or one genre with multiple labels.
It's all blurred lines. It's always been blurred lines at that point, you can always have tunes that are like jungle and still have the drum and bass like ethos.
It is a topic that can be discussed and argued and has been since the term jungle and drum and bass entered the junglist culture.
Jungle was an era. That's how I see it.
If you wanted to say, all right, well, this is jungle and not drum and bass, I would go even pre-94. Sort of like late 92, early 93, that's when the first sort of, this heavy sub bass lines and these crazy breaks, that was when jungle, the sort of term, was first coined.
Jungle was an underground scene in the UK, okay? Suddenly it blew up, media was all over it, but they couldn't handle the name jungle because in England it has racist connotations. So the media picked up on the drum and bass, because some people called it drum and bass, it was like the drum and the bass. So the media use the term drum and bass to describe this new music. So to me, it was always the same thing. I think in America, it definitely has this differentiation, like maybe the drum and the bass is a steppy thing and the jungle is the clattery breaks, whatever. To me, it's the same thing. It's just evolution.
When viewed on a historical timeline, jungle was the original term. Drum and bass was eventually coined by the media covering it and is now still the overall accepted classification for the genre.
To me, they're not a separate entity. I mean, some people call it jungle, some people drum and bass, you know. I guess drum and bass is more like a two-step breaks and a more heavier sound, you know. And the jungle is a more organic sound, more breakbeat orientated, not so regimented.
If you ask me what jungle is, I would definitely say it's the more reggae-influenced side of drum and bass.
The debate runs deep, but to many, there's an obvious difference in the genres, jungle or drum and bass. And every junglist has an opinion.
The way I would differentiate jungle and drum and bass, jungle was sample based. It was before they really had proper production equipment. So everything you're trying to sample, drum breaks, you're trying to sample all these crazy things. And it was, there was a backlash against that. And the Ed Rush and Opticals of the world were like, no, we're gonna make all the sounds ourselves. And that was drum and bass.
Jungle has definitely become known as like the original sound with all the like lots of amens and edits and samples.
Both share many similarities on multiple levels, and with the music so diverse and eclectic in one genre, it becomes easier to understand why intelligent enthusiasts continue to debate its classification.
Explain like this, you got hip hop and rap.
Hip hop is everything, right? It's b-boy, it's breaking,
graffiti.
It's graffiti, maybe jungle is the whole lifestyle. Drum and bass is the music.
That's the way I look at jungle and drum and bass. Some people say it's drum and bass. Some people say this is jungle. But really it's all under the same umbrella. And I just call it all a jungle. I'm a junglist.
Like you can't play jungle with drum and bass or whatever. It's just older. D&B was called jungle, you know what I mean? That's what I've gotten from it.
Drum and bass was kinda, it started getting a little more intelligent. Cause at one point, the older side of drum and bass, or say jungle, was more organic.
There was a lot of like this sort of like, hey, we're gonna take this rolling, sort of soulful ghetto shit.
And then it started getting a little more technical.
We're gonna make it computer music. Boom, gap, boom, gap, boom, gap, boom, gap.
And that at one point seemed like, when you said drum and bass, you were on the technical side of the music.
And brah, 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 brah.
When you say jungle, you were in like the culture, just like party side of the music.
Even the jungle sound is still alive, with a lot of producers I know now have updated that sound.
Jungle and drum and bass is a complex and broad form of music. The debate regarding what to call this genre, jungle or drum and bass, led to the eventual creation of numerous subgenres, each attempting to explain the specific sounds that made this then new genre so unique.
People came up with all kinds of other names like neurofunk and tech step and all kinds of stuff like that.
And there were lots of different tempos in the beginning. Then it sort of became streamlined. Then it sort of split off into different factions. And then dubstep was an even further fractionation of it.
The diverse subgenres in jungle and drum and bass are classified by the characteristics of the sounds and samples used, as well as rhythmic arrangement. There are many different ways to describe specific sounds or vibes in jungle and drum and bass. With subgenres in jungle and drum and bass, you have everything from the mellow, soulful jazz of liquid funk.
When I first started off making some tracks, you know, I would say that the liquid sound was really just sort of getting born at that point.
Liquid drum bass is has like that fulfilling moment. There's a lot of emotion into it. You can listen to it, you can groove to it, and it's something that you can like really, you know, make a part of your life like all day, every day.
A lot of people who do not like drum and bass will listen to people like LTJ Bookham and appreciate that kind of soulfulness that drum and bass gives you.
I wake up, I listen to like some, you know, like early Total Science, you know, it's like this real groove and it helps you get through the day, feel nice.
It's just like a flowing kind of sound for drum and bass.
So there was like a cluster of us. There was Red Eyes, who's from France, Alex Perez, who's blowing up now. You know, High Contrast was there, Saburico, Submorphics. You know, we were new to production, but we were sort of finding that liquid sound. So that was, it was a really healthy thing to sort of bounce some ideas off it.
To the bouncy hype of Jump Up.
I've no idea what Jump Up is. It's a label someone attached to this, that and the other. I've no idea. If it's like music that makes you jump up and dance, it's a good thing, right? You don't want music to make you fall down and go to sleep.
Somebody like Jay Smooth is like a legend out here. You know, he's one of the guys that really pioneered Jump Up for us. And I know at least like 10 friends that are in drum and bass now because of him and because of Jump Up, because it has those elements where it's not as aggressive, but it's still like it's catchy, it's rhythmic, and you know it's easy to catch on to. It's a great transition from like somebody who's not into the scene to actually get in and not be completely scared away from some like hard tech itch, amen.
Jump Up is more just straightforward party vibes.
It just gets you amped up, you know? I mean, it doesn't make you want to go fight anybody or anything like that. So, I mean, drum and bass ain't violent.
And to the heavy, dark feel of tech step.
There's a term, you say dark, but dark doesn't mean that it's super evil, like some heavy metal, like type drum and bass. It's not, it's a vibe. Dark is more of a vibe.
As Evil Intent, we were making halftime. That's what we called it, you know? Like, it's halftime drum and bass, it's just, you know, those are things. It's like a slamming hip hop kind of beat with drum and bass sounds going on.
I'd say we're mostly known for doing darker drum and bass, but we've done all kinds of shit. More experimental tunes as well.
We're talking about like 172 BPM, hard drums, heavy bass.
I just say the best way to describe Evil Intent is heavy drum and bass, so.
A hard style or like a hard step or like a dark style, things are changing up. You got crazy drum loops, harder bass lines, different edits, just more to work with when you're mixing.
There are various styles of beat composure, including ambient drum and bass, raga jungle, neurofunk, hip step, and even the halftime tempo of drum step.
Neurofunk, something that I'm real big into. It's one of those mid-ground genres where it's like it's not light, but it's not overly hard.
Future jungle is just jungle at a dubstep speed, you know, but the same elements as jungle.
What's called being called drum step seems to be kind of a dubstep sound palette, but done at a D&B tempo. It doesn't necessarily have to be that way. You could do a very soulful thing on a drum step drum pattern.
I also like the hip step dub-wise, slower rolling bass.
Part of the thing about subgenres also with drum and bass is it kind of separated into different scenes. When people started calling it liquid or tech step, you know, you'd have like parties that were specified for certain subgenres. And in a way, that kind of divided the scene a bit, right when the scene needed to be more unified.
I'm into good music at the end of the day. I don't care what kind of music it is. You know, I don't only play dark jungle music, or I don't only play reggae. You know, I don't want to be pigeonholed like that.
I like to mash up like liquid, dance floor, tech step, and I always throw in raga tunes, man. Raga tunes is really like my number one love in drum and bass.
Some artists that are significant to D&B history, people who helped meld the sound over the years, have taken the sounds they use in jungle and drum and bass to different genres. In the early 1990s, artists that developed jungle and drum and bass helped influence music production on virtually every level as the music industry turned to its current, modern, computer-based production. The sounds and beat structures are very apparent in many EDM genres, including dubstep, electro, juke, footwork, trap, and many more. These genres in particular were built on a lot of the same fundamental principles and by a lot of the same artists. What modern electronic-based music should or shouldn't be considered to be co-founded by this amazing, always futuristic, ever-evolving genre?
Reading cities also sort of, you know, so like Seattle I know likes a certain style, or Denver likes a certain style, Hawaii likes a certain style, or this club night is different from that club night.
Those sharing this interest have formed the most recognized and dedicated community in EDM culture. These events, for many junglists, have become a sacred meeting ground of like-minded individuals on a local level.
You've got to understand what's the difference between the UK and America, right? In England, you can have four different parties in four different cities and the same DJ will play all four parties. Phantom could play in Leeds, Birmingham, you could go down to Milton Keynes and play London and go to bed.
You go to the UK, you can go from the very northern part of England to the very southern part, and you've driven cross country in 3 hours.
Across the nation, not only in large coastal cities, but also in America's vast plains and rugged mountains, communities of junglists come together drawn by the music. America's corporate-driven media and its obsession with pop culture, coupled with the great distances between major cities, meant jungle and drum and bass couldn't flourish as easily in America as it had in the UK or other parts of the world. When you're out of your car,
in Texas, it's Dallas to Houston in 3 hours, Dallas to Amarillo in 3 hours, and Dallas to El Paso in 12, and then 12 hours to California. So the country land is really wide and spread out here, so the market's not the same at all.
It's easy to see why the growth of the scene in America was much different than in the UK in the early years. But that didn't stop the underground culture and techno enthusiast in the US.
Yeah, we started in this warehouse, it's on Georgia Avenue. Right now it's condos. But back in the 90s, it was like a totally rundown warehouse, and we rented the part of the warehouse that we used from this older Jamaican couple who had a lease there, and then this Ethiopian crew would bring in the sound system. And you know, we were in there with bottles of champagne and boxes of blunts, and I mean, it was the real deal, you know, it was the old school.
The jungle culture was embraced and emulated throughout the North American continent and worldwide. These underground scenes were very apparent on a local level, and the American four elements of hip-hop went hand-in-hand with the four elements of jungle and drum and bass. U.S. breakdancers loved the energy and breakbeats. Graffiti artists could appreciate the urban soundscape and found inspiration through the performance of the DJs and MCs. Locally, there was a place where all of this developing culture could thrive. The Record Store. The Record Store was the lifeline for the North American jungle and drum and bass scene.
Never was a regular vibe. So many spoke of being inside. Torn from the matrix to break the cycle. Life was hard fought just to take the ride. War paid with lies, friends stuck to genres. Never get high boxed in, that was our mantra. Remarkable, solitude meant community. Individuals embrace the fight. Become accepted, from a resistance. Be empathetic, but never dismiss. The fact we were united by failure. To understand true success, never forget this. But it was fabricated, a lie. We use it as a tool to inspire. Cause honestly, it's really based on a timeline designed to be as long as we desire. This is America, faith is a sword and toxin. Either use it or get used by it, those are your options. Believe in the cost we spent so many years just trying to prevent that it's not. In the American jungle, you can find the heart of a soldier. Fight in the battle of the humble, with only the beliefs of a culture. You see in the American jungle, you can hear the pain in our war cry. And soon we see the barriers crumble. We will see the stars and stripes turn black and white. Fight in the American jungle, you can find the heart of a soldier. Fight in the battle of the humble, with only the beliefs of a culture. You see in the American jungle, you can hear the pain in our war cry. And soon we see the barriers crumble. We will see the stars and stripes.
find the heart of a soldier, fight in the battle of the humble, with only the beliefs of a culture. You see in the American jungle, you can hear the pain and I will cry. Until we see the barriers crumble, we will see the stars and stripes turn black and white. Fight in for the American jungle.